Ham Radio Now, episode 122 from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference, September 2013, over in Seattle. And we are going to check with John Gibbs, NN7F. John is going to talk about BPSK31, new ideas for the next generation. And I'm not going to give John's whole talk right now, but I want to encapsulate, not even summarize, but encapsulate that what John is going to talk about is that PSK31 has not kept up. It could be doing much, much better based on the improvements in hardware that we've had since PSK31 was introduced. Turns out to be quite a while ago. Time flies. Not only have we not been keeping up with our old analog modes, we haven't been keeping up with our digital modes either. So stay tuned for that. But first, something I want to mention, and that is that you may have noticed, if you've been stopping by the Ham Radio Now website, that we haven't been keeping up. In fact, I put a notice here about the fact that we're not keeping up with the website. 117 is the most recent one up there. I may get it updated as I finish this episode and three more that I've got stacked up in the editor to get finished. I may be able to do that today, but it's going to be pretty late in the day by the time I get done. So, yeah, maybe not. What I recommend is that if you want to keep up with the current stuff on Ham Radio Now, at least right now, is that you stop by our YouTube page, youtube.com/hamradionow, and hit this subscribe button. And that will keep you up to date on everything that we put up on Ham Radio Now. So you can see 121 is the most recent episode that's online, as we are here doing 122. The reason for this, it just takes a long time to update the website and all of the other publicity and promotions and mailing lists and everything. We have so many different ways of letting people know, and the viewership is so scattered among them, Facebook and Twitter and QRZ.com and my own mailing list of customers, that it just takes a long time to get all that updated. So instead of updating all those things, I am trying to get more episodes out, since I'm pretty far behind on doing these TAPR episodes. So I'm just sticking things up on YouTube. I'm also putting them up on the Blip channel, and that is blip.tv/hamradionow. And you can see all the latest stuff there too. No particularly compelling reason to watch either Blip or YouTube, whichever one gives you the better streaming experience. So that's the way to do that. All right, so that's the announcement. We'll get to the talk in just a minute. We got to do our promotions for the folks that helped us get out to the DCC. And it starts with you. 115 hams with individual contributions. And I know that says 118. That's because three of them were the big corporate underwriters. So that leaves 115 with individual contributions totaling up to about $6,000. And then there were those corporate contributors. Flex is the first one through the gate. Well, actually, TAPR was the first one through the gate, but they get the long announcement today. So Flex was the second one. There we go. Flex was the second one through the gate. What they've got going is, of course, the 6000 series, 6500 and 6700. And these radios are doing that software-defined thing where they do a direct conversion pretty much right from the antenna connector through maybe just a little bit of stuff, filtering and maybe a preamp or two, and then on into digital and everything else done in digital. And behind that picture, you can see the new software they've got, what they're calling the smart SDR software. And that, I'm pretty sure that's what controls everything inside the radio and also on your computer. And with this system, they're doing all the hard work, all of the serious processing inside the radio. They put processors in there, moved it out of the user's computers, so the computer can now be a, what they call a thin client, a fairly low-powered computer. And coming sometime in the probably fairly near future is the ability to do this stuff on tablets, on phones, over the internet. That's not going on as I speak, could be by the time you're watching this. You never know. You know, you could be watching this sometime down the road. But that's what they've got in the works. If those radios are a little bit out of your budget, they've got a few more. The Flex 3000 series, or the Flex 3000 and the 1500 are still available. And these radios do the software-defined thing the way that Flex had been doing it before. They go through a couple of steps of analog conversion, and then a lot of the work is being done in your computer. So you need a fairly beefy computer to be able to run these things. It can be still a laptop, but it has to have some power to it. And more data going back and forth from the radio to the computer. So it's a little bit older technology, but it's also a lot lower price. So if you want to do SDR, and the performance specs on these radios are still pretty good. So if you want to do SDR and you want to work with Flex, but the 6000 series is out of your budget, at least for now, then check out the 3000 and the 1500. And next, our second corporate underwriter is Elecraft. The K3 is also a software-defined radio. Doesn't look like one. It doesn't look like the Flex does with all of the stuff going on a computer screen. It's all going on the knobs and buttons and dials and stuff on the radio. But deep inside, it is a software-defined radio. So it takes advantage of all of the ability to update performance and add features by downloading software and installing it in the radio. The KX3 is a cute little radio. It is a totally portable radio. This is not a control head. It's the whole radio. You can even put batteries in it. It's HF through 6 meters. You can put a 2 meter transverter in either of these radios, and it fits right inside, and operate 160 through 2 meters. So everything is included in the KX3 to be a totally portable station, except, well, for 2 meters, you can use a little antenna. But for HF, you'll need a little bit bigger antenna. And I want to talk briefly about one other product here in the Flex line. That's the high-power auto-tuner and smart antenna switch. And Elecraft is doing something that most other tuner manufacturers don't do. And that is that they are showing you the range of capability of the tuner to some extent based on the power that you're going to try to put through it. Now, this tuner is capable. They say it's a 500-watt tuner. But they'll also mention that it will go up to 1,000 watts if you're keeping your SWR to 3:1 or below, which is basically trimming a beam antenna or a dipole antenna to a part of the band that the antenna is not cut for. So if the SWR is not going above 3:1, it'll take you up to 1 kilowatt. If you're using it at the 500-watt range, it's good for about 10:1. If you're using it at other power levels, the power you can run and the frequency and the SWR are all sort of interacting. So you want to take a look at what your situation is in terms of antennas and power level. But it's still going to be one of the most flexible and higher powered tuners that is available on the market. So there's lots of tuners out there that'll do 100 watts, you know, most of them rated at 125 watts for your typical 100 watt transceiver, kind of, you know, like my ICOM 756 Pro 3 in the back there. But the Elecraft tuner will do significantly higher power. It is really designed to complement their 500-watt amp, the solid-state amplifier. So, you know, those two make a pair that are in the same power category and same frequency coverage and stuff like that. And that will let you use the 500-watt amp on antennas that aren't even close to being resonant on the bands you want to use them on. So no tune amp, no tune antenna tuner, automatic band switching, all this stuff is very cool. So stop by Elecraft.com and check out the pretty wide range of products that Elecraft has going for them right now. And finally, our third corporate underwriter is TAPR itself, and that means they get this pre-recorded announcement. TAPR is dedicated to advancing the amateur radio art. They're focused on digital communications in all its forms. And if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, you will find like-minded hams to both support and challenge you in TAPR. There are special interest groups and a bunch of specialty mailing lists to keep you in touch with hams who share your niche. You'll also find kits to help you get started building stuff. You can start with simple projects and work your way up to a full high-performance software-defined transceiver. But you need to know that many of the kits are done as limited production runs just to get projects off the ground. Then TAPR members and their designers move on to the next project. So if something piques your interest, don't wait too long. TAPR sponsors the DCC, of course, along with the ARRL, and they host forums at some of the larger ham fests throughout the year. You can expect a big presence at Dayton with a booth, a forum, and a dinner. They publish their quarterly newsletter, the Packet Status Register. And I love that they've kept the name Packet in that. Yes, Packet is still around, and TAPR keeps their hand in it. But like TAPR itself, the Packet Status Register is now all things digital in amateur radio. Membership in TAPR is $25 a year. That'll get you a discount on some of the kits. And of course, I'm going to point you to their website, TAPR.org for more. And my thanks to TAPR, Elecraft, Flex, and of course you for making it possible for me to get out to Seattle, have a great time, and shoot all these programs and get them online a little bit slower than I'd hoped for. But let's get back to Seattle and check out John Gibbs, NN7F, talking about making things work better in PSK31. And Steve, if you would do the honors.
All right, so we'll get back on schedule here. Nice, take a little break. Like to introduce John Gibbs, NN7F, on his high-performance BPSK31 Ideas for a New Generation.
I'm John Gibbs, and I'm a self-professed nerd, okay? I've got an MSEE focused on DSP communication theory. I'm currently an engineering manager and work on firmware and hardware projects, all in RF commercial communications. I don't get to play amateur, but that's my nighttime career, and then I get to play and like to do DX. And I also like to get a chance to look at some of this stuff that I never get a chance to look at on my job, in my day job. So, here I want to share some of the work that I've been doing and the research that I've been doing on how we might improve one of our most popular modes of digital communication, and hopefully get people interested in it and get some other people working at it, because this is a big project and it's certainly nothing that I know all the answers to or have all the capabilities of going after it. So I'd be more than happy to work with other people and encourage people to do their own set of improvements to what's going on. The focus is certainly going to be on our most popular mode, the BPSK31, but the ideas and the basic math that we're doing applies to all of the digital modes, so we can certainly extrapolate out from it and go on from there. And again, I'm not trying to introduce a new mode into the system. We have a lot of new modes. They all have nice characteristics, and various trade-offs have been made on them to improve various things, but I'm going to focus on just improving our existing mode, keeping the same over-the-air standard, and just focus on the receiver's errors that are happening. First off, I want to start by demonstrating to you, that we actually have the opportunity to make an improvement. It's kind of hard to believe, but we've had PSK31 on a PC and sound card for almost 15 years now. That one blew me away. I guess I'm getting old. And of course, in those 15 years, we've had good old Gary Moore's law hitting us big and heavy. We see it all the time in the stores and in your iPads and whatever else. Our ICs are doubling in capability, as in the number of transistors, every 2 years. That's varied over the time, somewhere between 18 months and 2 years. Okay, this graph's from Wikipedia. And yeah, it's got a straight line plot on 2 years going through the number of transistors that they're putting onto microprocessors in particular. But probably less known and less thought about is another Intel executive, David House, pointed out that as we shrunk the transistors, of course, the clock speeds went up. So our signal processing capability not only went up by the number of transistors going from 4 bits, if you can remember that days of the 4040, you know, to 8 bits, to 16, to 32, 64, et cetera, okay. But we're also clocking faster when we're still doing 64 bits. A heck of a lot faster than you could have ever envisioned on a 4040, you know. Because Moore's Law, again, dating myself, goes back to 1965 when he made this prediction, noticed and said, gee, we got this nice exponential growth, doubling. Okay. So in that time period now, we've had 1,000 times improvement in our PC DSP processing capability since the introduction of PSK31, which is just mind-boggling improvements, and we're not using it, okay? So if we want to make ourselves backwards compatible with all the transmissions that are happening today, which is the basic objectives, then we need to go through and say, what can we do with that 1,000 times processing in terms of improving our reception? Okay. I choose to break the project into two phases. I spent a lot of time just trying to go over the academic literature, and there's a tremendous amount of it out on the internet, of how PSK works and what all of the impairments, to use the communications term on it, that happen as you transmit phase modulation across the air, and what happens to the signal and what you can do about it. I chose a very old platform, WinPSK31, because it's open source code, okay, and it was very easy to modify. Another reason for picking it is after Mo developed this, it was put into a DLL format so that you just didn't have to use his user interface. And that DLL interface program is called PSK Core, and that's used in the vast majority of all the programs we have out there for PSK31. So they're really all built on the same thing, and if we solve the problems in WinPSK, we will have solved it in a huge majority of the products that are out there today. Before I go any further, I certainly want to acknowledge that we're building on a lot of great work in the past. Of course, Peter actually introduced us to PSK31 by making it available on Windows and sound cards instead of having to have specialized DSP cards out there that it did very initially. Mo Wheatley did the WinPSK and has the open source. That was one of the first really successful programs, long gone at this point in time, of course, but still very valuable and, like I say, the core of a lot of other programs. And then I want to introduce another name. Daniel wrote an article in QEX a few years ago that compared all of the modes of digital modes on HF communication. Okay, and he used software simulations of the ionospheric propagation and compared, you know, RTTY and PSK31 and the various modes. So we've got some hard data to compare these theoretical results against. Okay, so now, having introduced what we're doing and why, let's go ahead and review a little bit about the BPSK operation so that you can understand what we're trying to do here. PSK31 is based on something that Peter called varicode, for a variable length encoding. What's going on? And it has certain properties that we're going to exploit when we're going to try to reduce the errors and improve the performance. The first thing that happens is varicode always starts with the one bit, okay? And it always ends with two zeros in a row, okay? And then in between is a variable length that will go, but obviously we can only have lots of ones and an occasional zero scattered through it, because as soon as we hit a double zero, we're going to say we're on to the next character, okay? And to compress the data as much as possible, he said, well, let's make the most common characters the ones that are the shortest length so that we can transmit at a slow rate and still type at 50 words a minute. I can't type at 50 words a minute, but he decided that was what he needed to do for chat mode. So the average character in, when you're transmitting in English turns out to be about 6 bits long, okay? Instead of, for instance, like, you know, the 8 bits that you're doing when you're doing ASCII. So it sped the system up. So this code is actually very closely related to existing code called Fibonacci code, which means that a lot of the mathematics and the analysis has been done already. So again, we can build on what's out there in the world. But all in all, it gives us a very narrow band signal. It's you know, approximately 50 hertz wide, sending it at 31 and a quarter baud rate. Okay. Then once we've coded that data, we have to, of course, modulate it, and we modulate it or encode it on the system by every time we see a zero, we flip the phase. Okay. If we don't, if we're going to transmit a one, we don't change the phase. Okay. So he did that so that you could have idle messages that were continually keeping the clock synchronized. Okay. Now, on the receive side, what we did with the capabilities we had at the PCs at the time was we compared two adjacent bits. The last bit I received, the current bit I received. And if they're the same, it must have been a one that was transmitted. If the phases are different, it must have been a zero. Okay, that's an extremely common way of doing it. Most of the modems that you see and systems that are out there using PSK are using that system, just the two adjacent bits. Okay. And then, so we decide whether we had a one or a zero that was transmitted, and then we look it up, and when we see the double zero, we look it up in a table, and we decide what character was sent. Pretty straightforward. Again, because of the limitations at the time, there's no attempted error correction. Okay, we don't try to say, oh, I can't find that particular stream in my lookup table. What do I do? And the answer is do nothing. Just put a blank in. Okay. With where we were there. So obviously there's an opportunity there to try to back up and try to say, well, that can't be right. What is right? Okay, and push our way through that. So that's the basic thing that of how it's operating today in the existing software. As I say, it's a good match to what we had. I don't want to, you know, throw mud at anybody. There's no way we could do some of the kinds of things that we're doing today with 1,000 times improvement 15 years ago. Okay. And certainly the performance that we got out of it is extremely good. After all, look at the popularity of it. And we've all been able to communicate under situations where you can't hear the signal, but it's showing up there on the screen and it decodes. You know, it's impressive. But certainly one of the limitations is this conventional detector that's simple. And the other one that's directly related to that is this conventional detector cannot handle the fading situation. And we'll get into that and we'll show you some real examples of that here in a few minutes. Okay. So we need a better detector. There are better detectors and technology that were out there. One's called a Costa loop. It's a form of a PLL. To try to extract from the data that you're transmitting, which of course, when we're doing phase shift keying, we don't transmit the carrier. It's a suppressed carrier type of operation. And so we have to restore the carrier if we're going to be able to have a reference to decide whether we've transmitted one or a zero. Okay. There's something that's called multiple symbol decoding, which as it's implying, is let's look at more symbols. Let's try to average out the noise and see if we can't make a better estimate of what data was sent. And then there's a totally different technique, which is almost a turbo kind of a scheme, where we take our initial decisions on what data was sent, and let's multiply it times the data, the actual received modulation. So we'll try to remove the modulation and just have the carrier left behind. Those are the three basic techniques that are proposed out in the literature and have been used. I chose to just take the center one, okay, and work on the multiple symbol decoding, and it turned out to work very well, so I didn't pursue on the other ones. Okay. The other thing that we need areas for improvement or have opportunities for improvement is that we're not using all the information that we know. Information that we call a priori information, if you're a communications engineer, which simply means I know it before you ever transmit it. I know certain things. I know you're going to do varicode. You know, I know that you're transmitting, you know, in English probably, you know, and I know the characteristics of the signal. Okay. So with that kind of background, let's go ahead then and talk about the actual measurements I did, the simulations that I did, and what kind of things that we saw happening and the improvements we could see. This is just kind of a little block diagram of how the WIN PSK software works, okay? Obviously very basic, just, you know, it's got the transmit software, it does all the modulation, the bandwidth limiting by shaping the waveform and all. But instead of taking the signal and pushing it out the sound card through our transmitters, receivers, antennas, it has a demonstration mode where it'll take that signal and add AWGN, which is a word that you'll hear a lot, okay, which means additive white Gaussian noise. This is in every single paper. There must be millions of references to AWGN on the internet, okay? All it means is, yeah, just like we hear noise when we're listening to our receiver or get introduced by our receiver or whatnot, it just adds noise to it, okay? And then it puts it through exactly the same software that we would be using on receive. So it's a pretty good simulation of an idealized situation where we have a good communications channel. We're not getting a lot of fading or anything else. We're just hearing some noise. So it's a nice little demonstration mode, and I developed from that and did the simulations that we're doing. Now, Daniel used a little different principle. First off, he was running multi-PSK, which again is based on the same core software. But he's actually going out to an external program called PathSim that simulates the ionospheric propagation. Okay, and I want to compare the results to that to get some reality to all of this academic exercise. Okay. So to compare the results, it turns out that in Multisim, they have a demo mode that sends a continuous string of eights. So it's easy to see what the errors are in the transmission. Okay. So I had to modify WinPSK to send us a series of eights. And I also modified it so that it would run faster. The demo mode has a deliberate pause in it to make it work basically at the PSK31 mode speed, you know, which is relatively slow. Okay, I took that out, and again, having 1,000 times the processing capability, you know, the thing just blazes away. So Daniel was hand counting and said, oh, I'm going to take 200 characters and see how many errors I have, because that's about as far as I want to count. You know, thank you very much, you know. Well, since I was making the computer do it, I had it modified and had it count the errors, so we did 10,000 averages. Okay, of course, that improves my confidence intervals and allows me to have a lot tighter data and results that were going on. So doing that, we get these kinds of curves. Now, this is just a theoretic curve right here, okay, using the traditional mode that you will see in all the literature as you go through. We're plotting bit error rate, okay? So as we know, having done a lot of data transmission, that's a pretty critical thing if we're transmitting files or whatnot. The bit error rate here is on a logarithmic scale, so that we're going from, you know, only a tenth of a percent types of numbers, you know, and going down to part per million type numbers. Okay. And the other one that you'll see when in the academic literature is they're using something called EB divided by NO. Okay. That's the energy per bit. It's a normalized signal power level types of things. And N0 is the noise in a 1 hertz bandwidth. So it enables comparison of a lot of different modulation techniques and decoding techniques on a normalized scale. However, we're not very interested in that. I'm not interested in the bit error rate at all, actually. What I'm interested in is the character error rate. Okay. Now, to get from bit error rate to character error rate was one of those head-scratching things for a little bit, and said statistics. Oh, no. Oh, yeah. Well, let me see. What's the odds that I'll have no character errors if I have a certain bit error rate? Well, it turns out not to be too bad of a problem, but it's been a long time since I cracked a statistics book. So anyway, we convert, you know, the theory and predictions from bit error rates to character error rates, which is what we're seeing when we're actually doing our simulations or over the air. It's just, did I get the character right? The difference is fundamentally, of course, I could have multiple bit errors in a single character and it's still one character error. Okay. So this plot that I have here is the same format that Daniel used, okay? And again, he went in and he plotted the character error rate as logarithmic because of the wide dynamic range. He's got it all the way up to 100%, you never get anything right, to a tenth of a percent, which is virtually perfect. You know, one character in 1,000, I'll give you that's perfect. you know. And then, of course, it's been replotted back to our usual signal to noise in a 3 kilohertz bandwidth. Okay. In other words, what you're hearing out of the receiver, because normally, of course, we're using the 3 kilohertz bandwidth and looking at the entire spectrum of the digital signals that we have. So we've got here the solid line is what the theory says a differential detector should be doing. Okay. And then we have Daniel's measurements, which are these lighter dots here, the multi-PSK. Okay. They vary from the theory a bit, particularly when you get way down here at the bottom. Okay, they vary. That's again because there's so very few errors, he doesn't have a, you know, he's got a very large confidence interval, you know, because it's, you know, a difference between one error and two errors is going to make a huge difference on that blot. Okay. I don't know why his errors are a little bit higher here. That could be the synchronization circuits and whatnot not working very well under high noise conditions. Okay. But when we did it with WinPSK and our 10,000 averages, as you can see, they're just lying right on the line. It's amazingly close, you know, in terms of the performance. So it gives me a high level of confidence that the theory that we're working with is good. And therefore, the improvements that we're going to try to make are going to work. Okay, took the same data and just put it onto a linear scale and only went from 10% error rate down to nothing. Okay. Reason for that, of course, is anything more than 10% average word is five characters. It's getting kind of ridiculous in my mind. Every other word's wrong, you know. So pushed it onto that kind of a scale, and I don't care about the bottom end of the scale otherwise. Again, I can see a tenth of a percent just down in through here, and that's perfect as far as I'm concerned. Okay. So that's the kind of plot, and again, you can see that it lines up, even when you can see it here linearly, extremely well through the region that we're interested in. Okay. Well, on the other plot, you may have noticed I had a dotted line there for another theory. Okay, that's the theoretical best we can do if we're just detecting bit by bit by bit. It's called a coherent detector. Okay. It's a detector that somehow knows what the carrier phase is at your receiver, even though it's not being transmitted. Okay. Sometimes that's called genie-aided, because it's like there's some genie sitting in there in the box that knows the answer. Okay. And so you see in the academic literature where they want to just focus on one particular area, they'll leave everything else as being perfect, and they'll say, it's genie-aided. So that's the best we can do. And you can see that if we could do that, you know, we could reduce that 10% error down to about 4% error. Well, that'd be a pretty dramatic improvement for one simple change in the detector. So it seems like it'd be worthwhile to pursue. And if you wanted to use QPSK, it's even better. Okay, there's a more dramatic difference in it, and you gain a lot more in the process. So it's pretty dramatic. That just, if we could change the detector and improve it, if we could have a perfect detector, we'd make quite a difference. Okay, that's nice, but what are we going to do for reality? Well, it turns out that if you use a practical detector called an MLSE, and that means maximum likelihood sequence estimation. Okay, that's about as heavy as we're going to get. Okay, all that says is, geez, what's the most likely sequence that was actually transmitted? I know what I receive. What the heck was transmitted? What's my best guess? Maximum likelihood, okay? So we compare the actual received transmission, a series of bits, and we compare it to all the possible things that could have been transmitted and decide which one's closest, okay? And it's just, there's a lot of math, but it really boils down to the same thing as our good old least squares fitting data types of things, you know. And the good news is that you don't have to look at the whole sequence. You get almost perfect results if you only just look back 4, 5, 6 bits, something like that. And that I determined by doing enough simulations and said, oh my, that's wonderful. We're close. And close enough, and as an engineer, close enough counts. So that's what happens under AWGN, okay? Just good old noise. Nice propagation going on. So what happens, though, if we have the real world, okay? And what does it do to BPSK signals, and what can we do about it, okay? Well, of course, we get different effects as we go through the ionospheric path and multi-hop and everything else. But basically, you're going to get three effects. We're going to get our additive noise. Okay, fine. We've been addressing that one. We can get multipath. Bad news. And we can get fading. So we've done noise. The only problem with that is we did Gaussian noise. Why did we do Gaussian noise? Well, it turns out that, of course, if you're up at higher frequencies, the noise is basically Gaussian. In other words, it's the usual hiss that you're used to. Okay, and that's pretty close approximation to Gaussian noise. But the real reason we use Gaussian noise in all the theory is because that's the only math we can handle. Everything else gets too messy. They don't want to do it, so they only just do additive Gaussian noise. Okay. But it works pretty well, and you certainly find that it works pretty nicely. However, get down into 40 meters, 80 meters, or heaven help you if you're down at 160, it sure don't sound like Gaussian noise. It's got lightning noise and everything else. We call it impulsive noise or Laplacian noise. Okay. And the detectors we're using, the software we're using, is optimized for this Gaussian noise case, not for lightning and everything else and whatever else is causing those noises that we hear on the bands. There's been some work down in Australia. They do a lot of HF data communication because of their distances. So they've been addressing that kind of area, and they've come up with various detectors that seem to work better under those conditions. But I haven't gone through and investigated that. I'm just investigating the simpler case at this point in time. That's one thing that you'll hear all the way through here, is there's a lot more work to do. There's some areas for improvement that we can continue to push on here. Okay. Final effect in propagation is multipath. Okay. We have a situation, of course, that we're transmitting data at very low rates, 31 baud. Okay. And so fortunately, under any normal atmospheric conditions, there's not enough time delay between all the paths that you're running into that becomes a problem for our low-speed data transmission. If we were running high-speed data transmission, multipath would be a serious problem because you get it delayed enough that the previous bit would interfere with the current bit that you're trying to receive. Okay, but we don't have to compensate for that because it's a very small percentage of the error. And that's been established by theoretical investigations, and it's also substantiated in Daniel's article where he was doing it with the path sim. Final effect, and the worst effect as far as we're concerned, is fading QSB. Okay. We experience on the digital modes, on these narrow band modes, something we call frequency flat fading, which just means that all of the frequency components of our signal experience the same attenuation as we go through. If you listen to your FM broadcast radio and are in a bad reception area, you'll be experiencing fading that is not frequency flat, it's frequency selective, meaning that you get big notches in the frequency spectrum where the signals come in canceling each other. Okay, and so, you know, you're sitting there and the FM sounds terrible and you drive the car just, you know, a matter of inches forward and all of a sudden they don't cancel anymore, they're canceling at some other frequency. Okay, and it sounds just fine. Okay, but in this case, everything's affected the same. And of course, we know that the amplitude's going down. We hear that all the time on our voice conversations and hearing the QSB. But what you don't hear in the voice conversation is the phase is also changing. Okay, and it can be changing pretty rapidly. And since we're trying to detect differences in phase, that can become a very, very serious problem. Okay, and of course, we normally characterize that calling it Doppler shift. And here's the standardized industry tables, the CCIR, which says that, you know, you're getting Doppler shifts and, you know, the simulations and the normal things that you encounter in the environment have about this much shift. Notice I haven't gone to polar flutter or anything else like that, because that's kind of pushing things, to say the least, to try to recover through those kind of situations. They get up into the 10 hertz or higher types of rates of shifting. So it gets right up in the same data rate where we are, and so there'll be no hope of being able to extract information when the channel is changing as fast as our information is. Okay, what happens with our differential detector? I said that it didn't work very well under that situation, okay? And here's Daniel's plots of what goes on and the theory, okay? The really nasty thing that happens is there's an error floor. I don't care how much you increase your transmitter power, your error rate doesn't go down. There's so much variation in the phase from bit to bit that you hit that limit before you hit the limit of the signal-to-noise ratio. You get clobbered. That's a plot under that poor condition of the CCIR, okay. It's a little better under the moderate conditions when we're not fading quite so bad, but it still has a floor, okay. And the detector technology and the approximations that are made and everything can't handle fading. That's just a fundamental detector problem with the detectors we're using. There's one other thing to notice on this plot is we're way up here on the signal-to-noise ratio, okay, over here. We were down at minus 11 before, okay? We've lost 17 dB to be able to get it. I mean, we got to punch up the power really high just to get anything, and then we're still not getting it through well. So there's a lot of room for improvement here if we could know what to do about it, okay? Okay, Doppler shift is what's causing the floor going through this conventional detector, okay? But we can do it. We can correct for that. There are theoretical ways of doing that. They add to the complexity, of course. We have to do a lot more calculations, but what the hey? We've got the signal sitting there. Okay. This is the kind of standard plots that you see of fading in the academic type literature. It's artificial, but it's as good as any for showing what's going on. They use a normalized average power up here at zero, and they say sometimes you get a nice strong signal, but you know the real problem is that down in here you get these fades. Okay. And as I say, not only amplitude phase, but phase fades. Now we can take out the phase and we can correct for that and get rid of that floor. But we can't take out the amplitude phase. We don't have the signal. Okay. Sorry. Okay. So we can then estimate the character error rate, okay, by kind of saying when you drop below a certain threshold, or 11 dB on the original one, guess what? You know, you've lost the signal, and it loses very quickly. So you can basically just do a simple binary. If it's below this level, it's an error. If it's above the level, it's good. Okay. And there's a whole bunch of theory that's built around that, but it makes the whole math a whole lot easier, because otherwise, the integrals and whatnot that you're getting into in this math is enough to blow your mind. And like I say, I got a master's degree in it, and it still blows my mind, okay, in terms of what's going on. Okay. The theory, as I said, needs improving. You may have noticed back here that that theory doesn't always agree quite as well with the data as it did under the Gaussian mode that we were looking at earlier. And it's not too bad, but it's not exact, okay? And the problem is that basically when we were doing Gaussian noise, the noise was independent from sample to sample. But fading, of course, it's correlated. You know, we know the fade lasts for a length of time, you know, so you start losing consecutive bits. Okay. So there's our below time, percentage of time below the threshold. And so we'll set our threshold by our desired error rate. In other words, we'll just have to keep, you know, pushing our threshold further and further so that we have less errors. Push it further and further down. This, again, is just a straight theoretical plot of BER, okay, here. But what it really shows is just how dramatically that if you just have the AWGN, the noise case, or the fading case, and by the way, it's called Rayleigh fading, don't worry about it, okay, which simply means we don't have a direct path. Ricean fading says I've got good signal coming straight at me, and I've got reflections giving me multipath. We never have that if we're doing HF communications. We just have what's called Rayleigh fading, which says we're hearing nothing but indirect paths. Okay, fine. But the point being is that if you want to get down to a decent error rate, you have to increase your signal level a whole bunch. And this is with taking out that phase error problem that we had with the conventional detector. This is just the amplitude problem. Okay, so we can do that. We've done some experiments in terms of taking out the fading, but we've got a lot more work to do on that, so I don't have any data to present at this point in time. As I say, this is an ongoing experiment. But if we're going to address that problem that we need a lot more signal, we better figure out how to do better error correction than we've been doing in the past. And to do that, we need to start studying the properties of the signals that we're sending. And the first signal is that, of course, we're sending English text. We're not sending random data files. Okay, so each letter has a probability associated with it. This data I just downloaded from the internet, but it's based on Reuters news stories where somebody counted up the probabilities. And the first little surprise is E is not the most common character in the English language. Space is, because every word has a space after it. Duh. I thought I learned E in school. Okay. And of course, the table goes on and on, but that's just kind of typical numbers. And so, you know, that's what you're going to see in terms of how often you're going to see these characters. Well, how often you see the characters should give us a clue of, you know, what character was actually sent. You know, an E or a Z. I wonder, you know, if I have uncertainty, I think I'm going to go for E, you know, if I have to do a coin toss. Okay. So, Varicode, as I said, is designed to try to minimize the amount of bits I have to send on an actual English transmission, so the most common characters have the shortest coding. Okay, you can see this here. Okay, this is the length of the Varicode, and this is the probability of it happening. So that right down there is the space. And it takes 3 bits to send a space character. Okay, the next one up is the E, takes 4 bits. You know, okay. And then you're seeing that we're getting up in here into the 11 and 12 types of things on the very uncommon characters that we're sending. Okay. So that's what you basically got going on there. The average character is 6 bits. In information theory, it turns out that you should be able to do that with 5 bits if you had a perfect code. Okay. So we're pretty close. It's pretty good code. Okay. There's a reason for that, but I don't want to get into that, of why Peter made that decision to go on and add an extra bit into it. It's a balanced code, meaning we send out almost exactly the same number of ones and zeros for standard message, which is very important to keep from drifts things happening and whatnot. So it's a very good code that way. But there are some statistical levels at which there becomes more information available. If I have equal number of ones and zeros, I can't predict what the next one is, a one or a zero. So I can't do any error correction on the basis of that. Okay. But it is twice as likely that a zero will follow, or if you transmit a zero, the next character will be a one. Okay. And there's other higher order statistics like that that says there are patterns in this data. And that's one of the reasons there's more bits going on, is Shannon showed years ago in information theory that a perfectly encoded, highly compressed message looks like nothing but noise. There's no pattern in it at all. Any pattern is something I could have extracted out of it and not transmitted. So if I'm going to have perfectly encrypted message, okay, and then pound down, it's going to have to look like noise at the end of the day. Okay. So using those kinds of things, we should be able to go in and do some error correction. Okay. The first and most obvious error correction is if there's too many bits before I detect my double zero, I must have done something wrong, because there isn't any varicode that corresponds to that long message. Okay. So, you know, then you can back up and try to figure out which bit I actually decoded wrong. Okay, which is the most likely place to go. And we can use probability trees, which simply means that, you know, every message here starts off with 001. Okay, that's just the first thing that's going to happen. From then, using the standard, a dotted line means that a zero was detected, and the solid line means that a one was detected. Okay, so as we go, if we detected, there's a 56% chance, using just these statistics that I was pointing at, that a zero would be transmitted after that initial prefix, and a 44% chance that a one would be. Then likely 00101 is a 40% chance. Okay. 0100 is a 16% chance, which happens to be the space character down here. Okay. But at that point, looking at the next bit coming in, there's a 40% chance that a one was transmitted. So if I'm uncertain as to what was transmitted, I'm going to guess it's a one. And there's a way that you can incorporate that by changing the threshold. The threshold being normally was a plus one transmitted or minus one, was the phase in phase or out of phase. And normally you transition at zero. You said if it's a negative number, it must have been an inversion. If it's a positive number, move the threshold around. Since it's more likely that, you know, a one was transmitted, let's move the threshold down so that we say, well, anything up to minus 0.25, we're still going to call a one, a plus. Okay. So, and that's all in the math and whatnot, but that's the basic thing that we can do. We can push those numbers around and we can improve our odds on pulling out the signal. Okay. So we can do a little bit that way around and push our and improve our probability, which will help us in all propagation conditions, whether it's white noise or fading conditions. But finally, if we're really going to be able to improve the performance, we have to start looking at the hardware. Okay. Want to do it as much as we can with software to stay compatible, but eventually you have to get to the point where, excuse me, my signal is disappearing and fading. What am I going to do about that? And the answer is diversity reception. Okay. I need to be able to receive signals. I need multiple receivers. I need multiple antennas. Okay, you can do diversity other ways. I mean, you can do diversity by, you know, spacing antennas, you know, way far apart from each other and doing some reception and hoping that one of them has a good path at any particular instance. You can do time diversity, which is you keep repeating your call sign several times until the guy gets it. It's an ACK-NACK, if you will, but we don't use those terms when we're doing voice. Okay, you know, we just repeat messages, okay? So, but trying to do it in an automated manner and trying to get the message through the first time, we could use multiple receivers and multiple antennas, okay? Now, typically what you'd want to do is have a horizontal and a vertical polarization antenna, because due to the propagation characteristics, it's likely that one of those is going to be reasonably strong. And we'd like to combine them together with a fully synchronized local oscillators on both receivers, because we can't lose, we got to keep the phasing correct. Phase is all our information, you know. So they've got to be kind of specialized receivers. We're not just going to take and stack up our backup receiver against it and make it work. And of course, then we'll have, you know, down conversion, super hets, you know, on all that kind of jazz. Then we'll combine it together, and we'll have to change our software in the PC to combine those signals in an intelligent manner. We don't want to just threshold them, which we could, but we'd like to take the best of the information from each one of those signals and add them up and get even a better signal out of it. And that's really the techniques that are being used today in high-speed generation 4 data called MIMO, multiple input, multiple output. Okay, we'd only be concerned, of course, with, you know, half of that problem, but that's what we'd be doing. Well, given this group, you probably recognize what that block diagram ought to look like, okay? Why not have two software-defined receivers, okay, with the same local oscillator, okay? Why not? They're very, very easy to build. We're only looking at a 3 kilohertz band of data, okay? So we can share that local oscillator, and as a matter of fact, it might as well be a fixed tune as long as we're just building it for this application. Let's, you know, because we don't tune those receivers normally when we're doing PSK. We just take the whole 3 kilohertz spectrum, move it down into the range of the sound card, and then pull out the signals that we're interested in, which is particularly nice, of course, on any of the modern PSK programs because you can decode multiple messages at the same time. We can look at the whole thing. Because I don't have to have a VFO, I don't have synthesizers and phase noise pedestals and dynamic range limitations that come with a more versatile oscillator. So I'm not only cheaper, I'm better. When do we get that together? Okay. Yeah. And blocking dynamic range is critical. I mean, you know, somebody pops up in the neighborhood or one of those California stations that seem to blow me away up here, you know, it'll overload things. You know, or even if it doesn't overload it, the noise from that transmitter is in the middle of that signal I was trying to get, and it's gone. Or it just simply AGCs my receiver, and it just pushes it down, and my signal disappeared that I really wanted to hear. Okay? So if I built my SDR with a nice linear IF, which is not hard to do and not very expensive, I don't have to have AGC. I just have to have enough AGC to go through and make sure I don't exceed the dynamic range of my ADC, okay, which is very easy. Okay. And you don't want AGC because one of the problems that we actually have that's more subtle that I haven't been addressing is as your HF receiver tries to track the fading, it's shifting the phase. Its changing gain also changes the phase. So it's inducing another error all in itself, okay. So in summary, we do have an opportunity, in my opinion, to be able to improve our digital modes, and in particular, our most popular digital mode, and advance the state of the art at this point in time. A lot of this, you know, is new applications of some theory that's already been done, but not done. So for the first time in a while, we actually have the ability to go in and improve digital communications in a way that's not being done in the commercial area. Commercial area, of course, is pushing for really high speed. You know, how much more data can I slam across? Can I get video? You know, can I do this? Can I do that? You know, and so we, in this case in particular, are going for low speed. Totally different area, but reliable. And if we can make this successful, we can widely implement it because we, as I mentioned, we can put it on, we can port it over to the software that's being used, the DLL, that's being used by a wide variety of the platforms that are out there today. I have a list in the proceedings of this PSK core DLL. Okay, they're all using the same signal processing, which is why we all have the same sorts of problems trying to receive signals under less than ideal conditions. But I believe that I've shown it's possible. We've got the probabilities. It's within the realms of the technology and the capabilities of the PCs that we have today. And we can push it out. And then, of course, we can extend the ideas out to the other digital modulation modes, including some of the most popular, like RIDI, you know, can also benefit from this kind of thing as well. Any questions?
Yeah, I think you've done some pretty good work here. My only real problem is with the title of your talk. It really ought to be why BPSK31 should be retired.
Oh, okay. Yes.
In all seriousness, I mean, I'm absolutely serious about this. I mean, at some point, it simply takes too much work. It's more work to try to fix it than it is to replace it and do something based on that experience. I mean, I could, for example, you talked about doing diversity, okay? Mm-hmm. Well, the only reason you need to do that is because BPSK31 aggressively throws away all the other forms of diversity that are much easier to do, namely time and frequency. There's no frequency diversity because there's this fetish for ultra narrow band.
Yes.
And there's no time diversity because there's no FEC. So that's the only reason why you need to look at the one that's really hard to do, which is spatial diversity, multiple antennas.
Well, What you say is absolutely true, but all modes would improve, you know, and benefit from better detectors and better error correction, in it, no matter which modes that you were actually
but
using.
But my point is you've run into the stops here. I mean, you've basically shown that you really can't do a whole lot more. I mean, when you talked about maximum likelihood sequence detection, what that really is, it's actually a generic name for what a Viterbi decoder does. Now, if you happen to actually have a convolutional code there that a Viterbi decoder can sink its teeth into, you could actually do something with MLSE. The fact that you showed that you could not do much with it at all is because there's nothing there for it to really work with.
Well, I would argue that a 2x improvement is not nothing by any stretch
of the imagination. It is nothing compared to what could be done.
Mm-hmm. But you could certainly use other modes, and as I said earlier in the presentation, there certainly are other modes with other trade-offs and performance compromises in them. I mean, you know, you can get extremely unbelievable sensitivities using, you know, modes that can bounce off the moon and you can get digits. But of course, it's ridiculously slow. It's, you know, and you have to be time synchronized and whatnot. It's not a chat mode. There are all kinds of modes and all kinds of choices. Yeah.
Yeah, just a quick question. You were looking at the probability distribution of English language characters.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Given past received characters, have you looked at multi-character? You know, would that improve the probabilities as well? And how English is the English that people are using?
That's a very good question. And the basic issue is, yes, the statistics are available for, you know, CH is a common combination and TH and things like that, and you can use that. We haven't gone into that yet because, again, at some point in time, you really ought to be looking at dictionaries and everything else. It's the level of complexity is higher than anything like what I needed to get to just get started on it, you know, sorts of things. It's one of these things where, to borrow from Professor Gallagher from MIT, you use toy models. You know, start with something very simple, really understand what it is and what your limitations and where you can get to, and then, but they have a lot of insight into them, and then build and build and build from there. So you have to start simple. If you try to start at the whole thing, you'll never be able to get all the way there.
You mentioned the genie of coherent detection. What's wrong with using GPS as a universal time reference and agreeing where you are on time? That gives you 20 nanoseconds if you know what you're doing. So you have a common time reference, so you have a better chance of coherent detection.
Well, first off, the time reference is highly variable when you go through an HF propagation path. The path length changes. So we don't have an absolute time synchronization in terms of what's going on there. But the bigger problem is that the frequency is varying of the signal that I'm receiving because of the fading that's going on there. And it's moving around the Doppler shift. And so an absolute time reference doesn't actually help me. Yeah.
This is actually a maybe related question.
Mm-hmm.
So with the spatial diversity, how that's typically implemented, you require synchronized local oscillators and
yes.
synchronized clocks.
Mm-hmm.
Has there been any work into maybe having looser sync? So you could do something like if you had a series of receivers in a small geographic area connected over the internet and combining their signals somehow.
I'm not aware of any work being done, but clearly you could because, again, if you're receiving the same signal, you should be able to say, oh, these are out of phase by so much and be able to correct that before you combine them together on the information. I'm not aware of any work being done on that. It'd be a very interesting thing. I've always been interested in just being able to have receive antennas that were just small whip antennas scattered around my property, know where they are exactly by GPS and being able to combine all those together and have a directional antenna. It'd be wonderful. Then I'd love to transmit that way too, but that gets even harder.
Okay, I'm Dick Patchy, K2LCT. One noise thing that I found on 20 meters is this over-the-horizon radar for C-state radar.
Mm-hmm.
And is there any simulations being done to find effects of, you know, to decode under those conditions?
No, and that's just in general one of the issues that I have would like to investigate further is not just that, but what about the interference of a nearby PSK signal? On PSK. Peter and Mo both pushed really hard for very high rejection of adjacent channel signals. You know, they compromised the ISI and the other performance of it to get 70 dB of rejection of the signals. Well, in general, in digital, I'm not sure that 70 dB is needed, because in general, the digital tends to reject adjacent channel and even co-channel interference. So, no, I don't know the answer to that, but I think that it's probably one of those areas where, again, there's an opportunity for improvement.
Thank you.
Thank you.